that AI is evolving so fast. We have to stay tuned to WIFM, what's in it for me? And that's what's in it for me for the broker. It's the Tony Stark suit. It's like how to empower your team, how to bring AI with them. And he just started laughing. And he said, my users aren't going to use this. A transformational lesson I learned.
Hello and welcome to The Concrete Voice. My name is Arthur Ambartsomian, your trusted guide to everything commercial real estate technology. And today our guest is Todd Terry. I know that you're investing in AI, obviously you're building products. So can you tell us a bit more about that and also maybe some challenges that you faced?
Sure. Before? We have a CRM practice, Salesforce. We have custom development. It has nothing to do with CRM. We have lots of customers that we actually build custom applications for, in and out of the commercial real estate space. And we have these products that we build. Most of our products are specific to commercial real estate. We're embracing things that are going to make our users more productive. So talking about our CRM users, we're adding functionality to make search, as we were saying, you know, voice it and then find more accurate results as a result of that search. We've watched how search technology has evolved from 1996 to today. In 1996, you definitely had to understand the idea of tables and columns and fields, even as a user of a CRM system. On our very first commercial real estate application, I was lucky enough to do a demo to a broker, and it was the very first demo I ever gave. And so I did the demo, and then he said, okay, this looks great, but let's say I'm looking for 1,000 square feet of office space in, you know, this in this market, you know. And I said, oh yeah, sure. We actually have a tool for that called Quick Search, and I opened it and I said, first, you go here and you pick this field, and then you select the operator, which is in, and then you type the field, and then you go to the second field and you check this one, and then it's a drop down list and you pick this. And he just started laughing and he said, my users aren't going to use this. Mm-hmm. So that's where we started. So then, probably around 2009 to 2012, we started seeing much more powerful search where it was almost like, you know, LinkedIn or Amazon, where you could type in some information. It would search on an index, and then you could use filters and facets to narrow down those results. Much better jump. I mean, that had been in consumer applications for so long, but it was just starting to make it into enterprise applications. And I think we were even part of the leading edge on that, you know, when we were building some of our products for real estate. So huge jump. Now, where are we? With AI search, you can take the best of a natural language search. Instead of matching on keywords, if you don't have a keyword match, it doesn't find it. Well, now AI is great about using sentiment and vague definitions. AI can use, it can augment it with internet sentiment, what's going on in social media. It can actually take that information and match your basic search, which is the type of space you're looking for, and maybe the region you're looking for, and all this other information that's from other sources, and actually find something that's much more appropriate that you just can't do with index searches or database type searches these days. We are looking at either building or integrating with note-taking applications so that we know our users are using those note-taking applications. We want to make it easier for them to get those notes and those activities into the CRM system. If the system says, here are the 5 tasks that I think you should set up, that's great, but now they have to go create tasks one by one. We'd rather it be automatic. 2 of the biggest things we're doing on the product development side is a contract abstraction. It's one of the biggest winners and low-hanging fruit for commercial real estate and even more than commercial real estate. That's one of the things that we're very, very close. In fact, we have a couple of customers already piloting our Ascendix DA, as we call it. And we see all kinds of use for the things that this backend is doing to take data, pull out information, summarize information, create new data artifacts that can then be pushed into a Salesforce or something like this. There's so many use cases for that, just not even in lease or contract abstraction, but in other cases. Another thing that we're doing, we have a brochure and microsite builder called Composer, pulling the information out of a CRM like Salesforce through the template and into an artifact that is beautiful and something that they can present to their prospects. An offering memorandum, you know, just a number of anything that you would be presenting to a prospect. Well, AI makes this really interesting and fun. Now, challenges, you asked about that, and I'm finally getting around to challenges. One of the biggest challenges is to try not to do everything at once. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's so many, we're talking here today, so many opportunities to do so many things. How do we know which ones to go tackle first? And we have great relationships with many customers and we have conversations with them. They're contacting us. What are we doing about AI? We're contacting them saying, what's your AI vision? You know, how do you see it helping you in your enterprise? And every conversation is enlightening. It's exciting. It's energizing. They're energized. We're energized, but we can't do everything. So
right.
We have to pick the one or two or three things that we can focus on that we can actually take to market in a suitable amount of time to where if we come in too late, well, then there's going to be 10 other choices that our customers have. So that's probably our biggest challenge, staying focused. The second biggest challenge I would say is that AI is evolving so fast that we spend time trying to overcome a deficiency in an AI system that we're using, like let's use document abstraction as the example. So when we first started building and exploring the tools, these LLMs as the backends had varying amounts of accuracy because they didn't have the attention span that they needed. You know, so it's like if you presented it even a 25-page document, it would really understand the data at the end of the document and the beginning, but it would be much less accurate with the stuff in the middle of the document. And so when you're trying to get even a one-page summary, at first it's impressive, but when you start digging into it, you're seeing, oh, it missed this, it missed this, it missed this. So we had to implement something called RAG, you know, where we chunk it up into pieces and then basically based on the template, we're doing a summary just retrieving the information we need because the LLM has a short attention span. Well, then it comes out with a new LLM that has a bigger attention span. And so all this work we did in this particular type of RAG is a little bit obsolete. So then we switched to a different type of RAG for other reasons, maybe accuracy in actually pulling out fields of data. So it's just constantly changing. And when you're in the middle of a sprint and something else comes out, well, do you check it then or do you, you know, implement it later? And so that's another challenge. It's a good challenge, but at the same time, you risk coming to market with something that's already going to be obsolete. And our third biggest challenge, I would say, is talent. Like, there's not a lot of, you know, people who have developed using AI tools, understand it, technology, that they don't grow on trees. So we have to grow them ourselves or find them in the market. And so many, many of our team members are real busy on projects already. And so to have them stop and educate themselves mid-flight so that they can be useful to us in this way is not easy. It's a challenge. So I would say those are our challenges.
So you've been doing this for years. And looking back, what would you say is the most valuable lesson you learned from these challenges?
So I want to be able to answer your question with something recent, like what's helping us differentiate ourselves, you know, now that we're in this AI era. But I have to go back even farther. Like, in fact, I would have to say a transformational lesson I learned. We were doing a global implementation of CRM for Colliers International Canada. And they were so committed to implementing it right. We had a great project. Their president, David Bowden, was very involved. He wanted to personally make sure that the project was a success. They invested in the right way. They focused on the user. When we're doing our requirements gathering, we have to stay tuned to WIFM, what's in it for me? And that's what's in it for me for the broker. Always, you know, what's in it for the user? Or tailor, I would say, our requirements that way. Went on this multi-city training, and we were in the last city, was in Vancouver. We had all the brokers assembled. I personally did the training that day. And I finished the training, and then we're breaking for like the celebratory dinner. Everyone leaves, all the brokers leave. And I've got the biggest smile on my face. I think this is the best, you know, project we've done. This is everything we've done. And David, and I hope he doesn't mind that I tell the story, he's sitting there and he goes, you know, Todd, the product is strong. You know, the team did an amazing job. But I have to still wonder, why is it so hard to use CRM? You know, it's 2009 or whatever year it was. And he said, why is it still so hard to use? Brokers don't need to go through a training course to build their smart list and an Apple playlist. They don't need to go through training to figure out how to use LinkedIn and to, you know, build their network and find people. Yet we had to do a half-day training course, you know, for every user. And I think there must be something fundamentally wrong with enterprise software that we have to train them on this. And it popped my bubble, but it just like, it was like, oh my gosh. So I was defensive and I said, well, David, I think we addressed a lot of these issues with this and this and this. And he goes, yeah, it's okay. But it's not, he said, I want Apple CRM, you know, he said something like that. And their CIO, Varesh, was sitting there and he says, Todd, you need to go look at Fast. And at the time it was a indexing technology. And he said, you need to figure out how to use Fast or something like it to take data from a CRM system and make it available in searches to users that way. Mm-hmm. That's it. Just one sentence. But that interaction, it launched our custom development. And the lesson that I learned, it was how do we make our applications Apple CRM? But if we really want our users to adopt the system, we have to think differently, and we have to leverage whatever technology is available to us at the time to make it more natural to them. And that's why we're actually so excited about AI and what AI can do for the user experience with technology. This is a natural fit for us as a firm because it's been a 26-year endeavor to make applications easy to use for our customers. So this is exciting for us, and I think it'll be exciting for our users.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought it up about the user experience. As I recently watched some of the clip from Steve Jobs' conference, and I don't pretend to remember it word by word, but what he said is, we don't take the technology and come up with what we can do for users with it. We first see what user problems are, and then we look for the technology to solve it. So I believe that's a very good line of thought and a good idea to keep in mind when you are thinking about AI or AI agents as well.
That's an important lesson for our customers today, and for not just our customers, but for any enterprise, commercial real estate or otherwise, who's thinking, how do I implement AI? That exact line of thought is probably one of the best ways to approach it. What can I do to impact my business the most now? What is a pain point? Some pain point that I can address. Don't try to go out and just think, oh, this will be cool. Don't do that. You can't try to do everything at once. Pick the one or two or three pain points that you need to solve and look to see if AI is ready to solve that pain. It may not be. That will, I think, be the recipe for a successful introduction of AI in your organization.
You actually answered my next question. I was thinking, like, let's imagine that some commercial real estate firm is looking to adopt AI. And for example, you start using AI agents. So what do you think is the smartest first step they can take to get closer to it?
What I just mentioned is an important mindset. I think more than a mindset, though, is you have to understand yourself and your business. Is there some use case that is creating a lot of pain in the organization now? And if there's a pain with too many big contracts and you need to summarize it and abstract it and get it into your back-end system, that's a low-hanging fruit. And if that is something that's impactful, that's a good place to start. If there's some productivity issues with your team where these note-taking tools can make a difference, those summaries are very, very helpful. Like, I can take those summaries and I can pull out action items for me. I can pull out action items that somebody else said they were going to do that, so that during the next meeting, especially recurring meetings, I can come back more informed and prepared for the next meeting. So it can help address, productivity leaks. I guess the things we're talking about that we've been talking about are good examples. If you're imagining that AI can do something where it's actually replacing people, that's not what it's for. I mean, it's the Tony Stark suit. It's like how to empower your team, how to bring AI with them. Here, I guess this is another example that I think fits well. It was late 70s and early 80s when spreadsheets first came to the workplace. Before that, companies had to have roomfuls of clerks and bookkeepers that were tracking everything manually. And then if something changed, they had to go in and recalculate and recalculate, and it took a lot of people to do. Then the spreadsheet happened. There were probably predictions about what's going to happen to all the clerks. They're going to be replaced by spreadsheets because someone can just make a change and the spreadsheet automatically recalculates everything. Did it replace some types of jobs? Yes, but it created a whole new industry, which is financial analysts, which outnumbered the clerks and the bookkeepers much more. Mm-hmm. It brought data, which is oxygen, to an organization, and it allowed people to start doing much more effective high-level jobs, allow an organization to make quicker decisions, act more accurate based on information, give service to their customers much more quickly. So these are the kinds of things that I think we'll be looking back at what AI does, like the spreadsheet did for financial analysis.
Well, I think that's today we've had so many insights from you. Thank you, Todd. And the use cases, I mean, the examples, we can build a list out of today's episode and just share it for everyone to try if that fits their business model, their business problems. I think that was very, as I said, inspiring, insightful. Thank you very much.
My pleasure. Let's do it again soon.
Sure. And thank you for listening to this episode of The Concrete Voice. See you next time.